Numero 12.
Senatrice Galvez.
Colleagues, I rise today to pay tribute to an exceptional senator that graced the Senate with her passion, poise and rigor, a great woman that showed intelligence and courage in her parliamentary work. As many have said before me, Lillian Dick was a trailblazer in the Senate. As an accomplished academic and neuroscientist, she brought science and evidence-based policy to Parliament. She also set the tone for a more inclusive and respectful Senate. She constantly brought to light indigenous issues, especially concerning women, and she fought adamantly for the rights of indigenous people. Right up to when she left the Red Chamber, Senator Dick worked tirelessly to make it a respectful, harassment-free, and truly honorable space, notably through her last inquiry. She launched this inquiry after her harassment complaint against a senator was rejected by the Human Resources Directorate under the advisement of the law clerk and parliamentary counsel of the Senate because parliamentary privilege trumped the anti-harassment policy from 2009, even though the policy was silent on the matter. Colleagues, this is quite relevant as the new policy proposed by CIVA goes even farther in this direction of providing no specific recourse for harassment, even for staff who are not senators, where harassment occurs during parliamentary proceedings, which is, quote, broadly defined. In February of this year, Senator Dick explained that there is no adequate way for a senator to bring up a complaint for harassment during Senate proceedings by another senator, and that the application of parliamentary privilege in the context of the current harassment policy that was repealed before was heavily biased. Quote, the application of privilege in the Senate harassment policy is one-sided. While the parliamentary privilege of the harasser is taken into account to protect them, that of the victim is overlooked. The victim, too, should have their privilege taken into account so that they can carry out their parliamentary activities free from undue interference or obstruction caused by harassment. End of quote. The unacceptable harassment Senator Dick had to endure during parliamentary proceedings and the handling of her complaint both raises serious ethical, procedural, administrative, legal, and mostly importantly, parliamentary issues that these chambers must address. Colleagues, le problème d'harcèlement et de violence contre les femmes, surtout en politique, ne sont pas nouveaux d'aujourd'hui. Les femmes sont historiquement victimes d'harcèlement dans toutes les sphères de leur vie, y compris en milieu professionnel. Depuis plusieurs années déjà, des mouvements tels les MeToo exposent l'harcèlement vécu par les femmes. Encore, très récemment, des allégations sérieuses et inquiétantes d'harcèlement par une sénateur faisaient les manchettes à travers le Canada. Le Sénat n'est pas à l'abri du harcèlement et c'est provenant même de ses propres pairs. On nous a confirmé en chambre quelques mois passés que les ressources humaines ont bloqué plus d'une plainte d'harcèlement en 2019. Chacune d'elles achevée par ce tristement célèbre privilège parlementaire qui semble excuser tout comportement des sénateurs qui serait inacceptable ailleurs. Pourtant, les parlements du Royaume-Uni, la Nouvelle-Zélande, l'Australie ont réussi à moderniser leur définition du privilège parlementaire pour l'harmoniser avec une vision plus contemporaine. Sommes-nous satisfaits à vivre dans cette complaisance face au harcèlement auquel nos collègues sénatrices et sénateurs font face? Est-ce acceptable que dans cette chambre haute, lieu de révision législative et de réflexion d'importance nationale, nous acquiesçons à une atmosphère professionnelle d'inégalité, de violence verbale et psychologique? En 2019, l'Union parlementaire dont le Canada est membre présentait ses lignes directrices pour l'élimination du sexisme, du harcèlement et de la violence contre les femmes parlementaires. Dans cette publication, on notait que 82% des femmes parlementaires sondées avaient déclaré avoir souffert de violences psychologiques en cours de leur mandat. Pire encore, seulement 21% de ces parlements étaient dotés d'une politique contre l'harcèlement entre parlementaires, quoique le Sénat du Canada en ait la preuve même que l'existence d'une politique n'assure pas la protection de ses employés ni de ses sénateurs. During its comprehensive study on the matter, The national inquiry into missing and murdered indigenous women and girls has demonstrated that, quote, First Nation, Inuit, and Métis women live with an almost constant threat to their physical, emotional, economic, social, and cultural security, end of quote. Not only does this need to be eradicated across the country, but it has no place in one of its highest institutions. Lillian Dick will be honored if the Senate will tackle boldly and stop all kinds of violence against women. I do believe that the vast majority of you, colleagues, want to improve respect, collaboration, trust, and decorum in this chamber. I know this is a priority for the ISG group, as revealed by a recent poll. For a period of time this year, the Senate again reached gender parity, a first in a major national institution in Canada. This comes as we celebrate the 50th anniversary of the report on gender equality by the Royal Commission on the Status of Women in Canada. We are equipped more than ever to understand the issues of harassment and to address them with adequate and efficient tools that include both a changing culture and a solid anti-harassment policy. The February 2019 report on modernizing the Senate anti-harassment policy from SIVA Subcommittee on Human Resources recognizes this necessity to modify to account for parliamentary privilege in four different places in the report, but do not provide with details on how to do so. The sources provided also do not provide details on how to do so. I note with concern that unlike our previous anti-harassment policies in the Senate and the brand new harassment and violence prevention policy approved today, were silent on the matter of parliamentary privilege. Yet, it is our choice as a whole to waive parliamentary privilege in the case of harassment. It is our choice as a whole to embed harassment with our code of ethics, as harassment is an ethical issue. The new policy explicitly proposed to exclude all parliamentary proceedings from the process because of parliamentary privilege. Colleagues, as Lillian Dick would say, if we are taken out of the decision, then our parliamentary privilege has been breached. How can we explain this to the public? Both houses of parliament had to implement Bill C-65. One did so with a policy which does not explicitly exclude parliamentary proceedings from its application, and ours, which explicitly leave victims during parliamentary proceedings without recourse except calling out their harassers on the chamber floor if they are lucky to be senators. Forging ahead without change would not bring justice to our former colleague. To truly honor Senator Dick's trailblazing legacy, we must act on this important issue she had the courage to bring to our attention. Colleagues, Senator Dick has been a pioneer, a teacher, a mentor, and a friend who deserves all the praise for her exceptional contribution to Canada. I already greatly miss her insight, her intellect, and her professionalism. Thank you for all that you have done, Lillian. Now that you have passed the baton to us, may you enjoy your well-deserved retirement from the Senate. Merci, thank you, Chi Megwich.